Everybody, welcome to our weekly live streamed 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons role-playing adventures. We stream our sessions live on YouTube beginning at 9 p.m. Central Time every Sunday evening. You can catch up on previous episodes on my YouTube page, as well as weekly session write-ups on my blog at roguewatson.com. I'm Eric Watson, your Dungeon Master, and you can follow me on Twitter at roguewatson. Tonight I'm joined by my amazing players, Chris playing Kalinar, the Gold Dragonborn Paladin. Hello, Chris.
Hello, Eric.
Heather playing Mary the Human Monk. Hello, Heather.
Hi.
Raymond playing Kethra the Half-Elf Rogue. Nod in approval, Raymond.
Hello.
All right, you can also... And Reese playing Talus the Human Wizard. Hello, Reese.
Happy Easter, Eric.
Happy Easter. For our campaign, we use Roll20.net. For video sharing, we use Google Hangouts. For broadcasting and streaming, I use Open Broadcaster Software. And for bitching about terrible movies, we always use Batman vs. Superman. Also, happy Easter, everyone. I don't even know why I say this bit. I will just do the recap at this week's session. Someday you may surprise me.
Yeah, for a point of inspiration, sometimes you're not giving those out as willy-nilly as you did last campaign.
Yes.
And they disappear so fast.
And they disappear.
They disappear. They have a limit, so yes.
I think I've lost two of them that way.
And yet, no takers still, so here's our recap. Previously on Princes of the Apocalypse, I'll put you guys in the valley again for now. Our heroes had returned from the aerial manticore hunt to learn a startling revelation. Thanks to some subterfuge and skullduggery by Kethra, they learned that the Knights of Feathergale Spire were directly involved in some nefarious shenanigans involving the missing delegation from Mirabar. The party marched up to the pinnacle and confronted the Lord Commander. Thurl initially denied any wrongdoing, but things grew heated as the party grew aggressive. A fight broke out at the top of the tower. Kethra prevented reinforcements from coming up thanks to some ball bearings on the staircase. Thurl surrendered when the PCs proved more than a match, and Miri wanted information, not more killing. Kalinar, however, would have none of it, demanding the deaths of all that dwelled within the tower. The fighting resumed, and Kalinar blew his bone whistle the Eric Coker had given him. It just sounds like a really funny euphemism. Blew his bone whistle. They came swooping in to finish off any aerial reinforcements. The PCs had won, but the spire was still full of knights and acolytes. One level down, Miri managed to talk Sovra out of fighting, but the remaining residents appeared not so talkative. A giant battle erupted in the great room. Our heroes were drained of resources, health, and nearly their lives, but persevered. No further reinforcements came up as Sovra fled down the stairs. The party piled up a number of fresh knight corpses and hunkered down for a short rest and a much-needed break. We are back, or we're still in the Feathergale Spire. You guys will probably have to scroll down a bit, and a little bit to the right. I think you're right in the middle of this map.
Did you add the XP for that last guy?
Yes.
Yeah, scroll down the stairs.
Yeah, he added it to our sheets himself.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, yeah, after the fact. Because I found him after. Mm-hmm. Alright, so you guys have short rested.
I got back to spell.
Yeah. Did you already do your... Oh, no, you don't do divination until long rest, I guess.
Nope. We are boned if there's another fight.
Resources are still drained.
I'm boned.
I got all my key points back.
Boy.
My bone whistle's not the same as Chris's bone whistle.
How many XP points are y'all at?
8401.
Oh. Okay.
I'm at 8401.
Why? How many are you at?
8401.
Okay.
But the last thing Heather typed was 8401.
I don't know.
not
sure
and
it won't matter too much.
Bone muscle.
Today's word of the day.
Yeah, because that was that's what the last guy was, that +25 that she wrote. Yeah, that's what the initiate was.
Oh, okay. So she was still here for it.
Okay, we are short rested.
Has justice been slated? Slacked?
Smoted.
Slacked.
Have you smoted your justice?
I'm trying to remember where I left him. His mental state. Oh, that's right.
Kill everybody.
Almost. Yeah, almost. This tower is, as far as I know, empty. If it is, there is one more thing for me to do. But downward.
See the piss on the corpses.
You're just desecrating them.
Why?
What does this accomplish? Let's walk down the stairs. I think we've done everything.
Oh, what happened?
You moved while I was trying to grab you.
Oh.
Moving you down the stairs.
Things happen.
Oh boy, where are we at now?
There's your dead body.
More doors.
Ooh, more doors. Okay.
Yeah, more doors.
Knock, knock, knock.
Open.
Oh, what's in here?
This looks like a kitchen.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, this is weird. You guys actually fought your way through this dungeon before actually exploring half the dungeon.
Yep. Start at the top.
As we do.
Kill people first.
This appears to be the kitchen area. Sacks are heaped along the wall. Small pile of vegetables spread on the table. Huge steaming cauldron stands at the center. Wooden panels and knives hang on a rack next to a brick oven. Four wall shelves hold a dozen loaves of bread.
Are there any rations in here we could take? Or can we make our own lunchbox ration?
There are enough where you could each do about two rations between all the various foods and meats, salted meats and whatnot.
The breads.
And the breads. Sweet, dry, stale breads.
Okay, I'll take
two each have two more rations. Which
one are
you opening?
There's a door in here, too.
Bottom one.
Okay.
Is the door in there? Oh, damn. I didn't see that one.
That appears to be a, another room area, but it looks like it is more of like a dorm setup with multiple bunk beds instead of having, like, the full complement of, like, the desk and the chest of the other room. So you surmise this is probably where the initiates were bunked out.
Can I do a perception check to see if there's anything hidden in here?
Yes.
Damn it.
You are... That's pretty hard to do.
She falls and hit her eyeballs.
on
a bedpost.
I'm just going to walk out of the room shaking my head.
I see nothing.
I give up.
Let me go back and open the other door. I didn't see that.
I will check in this room. Or she failed.
You don't see anything of value or of note in that room. It looks actually extremely sparse, like literally a, like almost like a summer camp room before anybody moved in. Like there's no personal affections or anything.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, Mary, you recognize the solarium you guys were in the tour before.
Are these doors to the left?
Flowers and shrubs of many varieties grow in a labyrinth of planters. Spidery red and purple plants grow suspended in baskets in midair. Whole lot of stuff. Left.
Wait, are they... So they're not hanging from the ceiling or anything?
Yeah, they are.
Oh. Say, that's pretty cool.
Floating.
And this looks... Oops, I pulled that away. That is the entrance you guys were led through.
Oh.
Wait, where's the hanging pendulum thing?
That's it, right there.
Right here,
thing?
This eagle thing, yeah.
Ah.
It's the battering
oh, yeah.
ram.
Yeah.
Kalnar says...
Like we're at the beginning.
leave this place, fellow adventurers. I have one last thing to do here.
You guys really need to get a group, like a band name or something, because every time I write up a thing, I just say the party or our heroes. Like, we need, like, some kind of adventuring group, like how Penny Arcade is the Acquisitions Incorporated or something.
Justice Incorporated. Selling you all your justice needs.
All your justice needs.
Did we check out this door in the bottom right of the room?
I think
yeah, that led to the solarium.
Yeah.
There's another door over here.
Oh.
Right there.
Alright, let's check that door out.
Yeah, I think in the future I'm going to start using door graphics rather than the little white things. Just come with the map. Yeah. This appears to be the weapons locker of the knights. You see the weapon rack, which currently holds multiple long swords, suits of armor, shields, helmets, longbows, and several quivers of arrows.
Oh boy.
I'll take some arrows.
Kalinar's going shopping.
There are 4 quivers, and each quiver holds 20 arrows.
Ooh, 80 arrows. Did anybody else need arrows?
Nah. I haven't used my crossbow in a very long time.
You have a crossbow?
Yeah, it was really good. Level 1. I thought it was way too powerful. Then, yeah. Then I leveled up.
Then you learned how to bonk.
I'm gonna yeah. All
and crit with the firebolt last session.
Are there any magical items in here?
No, everything looks pretty mundane. Although it's in good enough condition if you wanted to use any of it, but specifically long swords, scale mail, shields, helmets, longbows, and then the arrows.
Helmets don't do anything though, right?
I don't think they do, no. I think it's just armor is armor.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a tab in the menu where you can just turn off your helmet if you don't want to see it.
Right.
Other video games.
It doesn't matter.
So you want to hide your helmet? You want to see that glorious mane?
Alright, what else do you need to do here?
Nothing that involves any of you.
What?
Whoa!
He's going to consecrate this ground.
As he's starting to walk away down the stairs, he turns to him and says, this place is a font of evil. And it must be completely and utterly destroyed.
Does this have to do with your new friends?
Well, they are victims of its evil, certainly. I intend to burn it to the ground.
All right. Well, don't let the peril get too perilous down there.
It is 400 feet above the ground.
Well, it will fall to the ground as it burns, right?
In theory.
All right, either way.
Yeah, I love how we're just kind of like all leaving Kalinar to his own devices at this point.
Yeah. I go down the stairs.
Want to have a cigarette?
Do you need a light?
No, I'm pretty sure it's lit.
I think you're still lit.
Tell us a cigarette.
Oh, yeah. I see what you're saying. Okay.
I think you're still a light for my spell from earlier.
No.
Kalinar, you notice that most of these stalls are empty now, which weren't like this when you arrived, except for two of them still have two of the hippogriffs in there. In fact, they were the two that you guys had rode earlier.
Oh, okay.
At least they're in the stalls.
Can I go over to them? I don't know where they are in terms of direction.
They're on this one and this left side, basically. At like 8 and 9 o'clock.
So you remember that you have to bow to a hippogriff.
Harry Potter reference, I love it.
Kalinar goes to each of their stall doors and opens their stall doors. And are they chained up?
They're not chained. They're in here. They have doors to the outside as well that they can obviously come in and out of.
Okay, well, I open those doors if they're not already open.
Okay. They seem somewhat agitated around you when you're coming in there. In fact, go ahead and roll animal handling.
Okay.
Let's see if you can flub this. All right. You whisper a few soothing words, and the beast seems to at least temporarily be subdued, even though you don't look like a knight of the spire. And you go ahead.
Sorry, okay. I'm attempting to shoo them out of their doors. Get them to fly off.
Shoo.
Well, they can't fit in this one. I assume you're opening the outer door?
Yes, the outer door. Yes.
Okay, yeah. The second you open the door, it bolts out.
Okay. And go and do the same thing with this one.
One more animal handling roll, please.
I was kind of hoping you were going to roll like a 3 or something and he would respond back, Kalinar gets kicked in the face.
Mauled by a hippogriff.
Alright, both of them soar outwards. And these stalls appear to be, or the stables appear to be empty.
Alright, Kalinar takes one of the 3 oil flasks he has on his belt. And begin spreading oil on all this shit around the stairs. And
okay.
Then he starts going up the stairs and spread that oil on the stairs as well as he goes up.
Okay, you actually went on each little square of the stairs. That's adorable.
And then when he's halfway up, he turns around and breathes fire down the stairs.
He has plenty of torches, but he's got to do this personally.
Oh, yes. This is
breathes fire down the stairs as he's looking, as his back is turned towards the explosion.
Exactly.
There's not propane down there. It's not going to explode anytime soon.
Right. It's going to take a while, yeah.
The oil catches a flame and seems to spill its way down the stairs, and you wait a few moments, and you see a lot of smoke beginning to waft up the staircase.
Okay. I leave and walk out. Once I'm to the party, I pull that whistle out again and blow it.
Okay. This time, only one of them actually shows up. And it's not the one you've been talking to, notably.
Oh, okay.
Quote, talking to. It does fly down from the top of the spire, you noticed. And seems to kind of cock its head and make a few like weird gestures that you're not quite certain what it means, but it appears to try to communicate and just cocks its head again. It kind of looks at you expectantly.
Give me 10 minutes.
This tower's going to be burning to the ground in 10 minutes. I point to the tower and just sort of make like a falling motion. Or just
okay.
A destruction. And then I pull the whistle out and try to hand him back his whistle.
Okay. He initially holds out to grab it and then he kind of looks at you and actually kind of closes your hand on the whistle and pushes it back. And then he gets down kind of on the ground and draws a very quick, almost elegant little gesture as if to looks like a beak face.
Mm-hmm.
And he puts a number of them. And then draws like two swords slashed and then draws the one of the symbols. Which, if you guys want to guess what these symbols are, what they designate, I can change what they're called on here. He draws this symbol in the ground on the other side of the arrow slash. And then,
okay.
This is it. I'm playing like I'm a Pictionary.
I'm guessing that's the symbol of the air cult.
Yes.
And the other one is a symbol of the earth cult.
Yes, I will update those.
From what I've gathered thus far.
And it seems to gesture. One of them kind of circles one of the beak faces and draws it over to the air symbol. And draws it over on the air symbol and then draws like chains around it.
I'm not sure what that means. Like they fought, they've captured some? Maybe that means maybe that means that the bird people have captured some of the air cultists?
He drew the bird symbol over to the air side and then drew chains around the bird one.
Around the bird one?
So some of his people have been captured.
Oh, okay. I get it. Yeah, you're right. All right, Kaladar draws his sword and just etches out the chains with the tip of his sword.
The thing seems to nod like solemnly and kind of points to the whistle and points to you as a gesture of like keeping it.
Okay. Kaladar will nod. It seems that this cult has taken more than your mother from you, Miri. We have others to look for as well.
Then let us go.
We're done here.
All right. The bird guy flies off, kind of makes a few circles around the spire, and then flies away. Alright, so you guys are still within the Sighing Valley, but if you want to, you can exit out to the outer overland map, if you wish.
I can't remember. Was there anything else of interest here? I can't even remember.
Right there.
There was a question mark over here, wasn't there?
That's what the Eric Crocra said, yeah.
Well, then whenever I look through the little spyglass thing for where the places that they were questioning the woman, and Thurl, what's his name?
Thurl.
That guy. That's what this was pointing to, is the little...
Okay. Very well. Let's head that direction. There was something about, like, a skull symbol in here, too, wasn't there?
Yes, yeah. It was about right here.
Here, okay.
Yeah, from up in the... You guys will have to go back down the trail, or go use the wingware, I guess. Or no, did you ever attune to that? I actually remember.
No, we haven't. Okay.
Does this actually require a long rest? I think I did figure that out. But you can see kind of a natural valley in this general area, not too far from the spire. In fact, kind of right nearby it. So you would be able to get to it if you wanted to, or you could skip it and just hug the river to the gully over here.
I don't want to skip it.
Face our problems head on.
That's right. Although, should we, like, take a long rest before we get into any more,
trouble?
Unknown areas?
Yeah. It's possible, for sure.
Can we just break right at inside the cavern that was coming down? Before we head out into the valley?
Well,
you kind of did set the castle on top of it on fire.
That's true. It may not be a good idea to rest directly beneath the burning tower.
But it would be warm.
That's right.
Free fire.
Although, I do have a point of inspiration, so...
Oh, yeah, you don't...
I want a long rest. Just in the off chance, I might use it.
Let's trudge forward.
All right.
What? No, you rest.
Oh, you want to rest, okay.
Yes.
yeah, you guys can...
I'd much rather have my spells.
Yeah, you guys can go down the trail and you can find a nice little tucked away spot beneath the shadow of the tower, which seems to have a few flames licking out of the bottom of it. And smoke is now billowing out at a pretty good stage, especially in the bottom stables area where there was a lot of like straw and hay and shit in there.
There weren't any animals left in there, were there?
No.
That's what Kalinar was letting them out.
Yeah.
At least that's what Kalinar is telling us, huh?
That's right.
You go to sleep with the dying screams of animals trapped in the stables.
Screaming hypocrites. Awful.
Kalinar goes to sleep happy. A smile on his face.
Alright, you guys can long rest. And all that entails, so you get...
two hit dice?
You get fully healed currently, and you get... Yeah, it's half, so half run it down, so you get two hit dice back. And then, yeah, Talus rolls, divination, you guys get all your spells and things. You do lose inspirations, though.
Oh.
Alright, I need to figure out which spells I want to use. Actually, start keeping track of that.
Spoon.
Oh, you can change time rest, right?
Yeah.
I think I can too, but I've just chosen not to mess with that. Like, the spells I've got are fine.
Also, at this long rest, you got anybody that wants to attune to the wingwear can do that.
I'll go ahead and do it. Why not?
All right. Are we all doing that?
Which has you physically wearing... the like leathery flappy things, kind of along your arms and torso, so that when you spread it out, it creates that like wingsuit look.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not gonna wear that.
But all of us are doing it.
Can you attune to it without wearing it?
You can, as long as it's not more than, like, I think 100 feet from you or something. So you can still attune to it if you want, but in order to use it, you would have to be actively wearing it.
No, I'm good.
You don't care about flying away at all. Okay.
Kato's gonna wear it. Forever.
I'm gonna sleep
even
in
after
it.
It's no longer functional.
In your mentor, you put whistle, parentheses, to summon the birdmen. It's fantastic.
That's right.
So you can, I guess, unattune at any time?
Correct.
Alright, I'll unattune my super bonker.
Detune. The super bonker, which one?
The black spider staff.
Okay.
The one that does the damage.
Is there somewhere to document this?
That would help me.
Yeah, I guess just put somewhere in the description that's attuned or not attuned. Because that is definitely a thing. I don't know why they wouldn't put it in the character sheet.
So three of us can fly, the other person will go left behind.
She can fall gracefully, though.
So. I can. But y'all can jump and fly down.
You may fall way behind doing that, though, because we're going to be literally moving horizontally at a good pace.
Alright.
Interesting to see how this works out.
Mm-hmm. I still have it in my backpack. I can attune to it next time.
I mean, like I said, you can attune to it now if you want, and just use it when you want to use it.
Oh, okay then.
You can keep it in the backpack. You know, just in order to use it, you have to be wearing it.
That's fine.
The only limit is you can only have three things attuned ever. So if you ever wanted to find the third thing, you would have to de-attune whenever you attune.
It's in the vernacular now.
The vernacular.
That's the first thing I have attuned.
Yeah, I think it's mostly like magic items you have to activate. Usually require that.
Oh, yeah.
Alright. You guys are unmolested during the night. Nothing seems to come near the tower. And the next day, the path leads open before you. The tower is now not engulfed in flames, but definitely still full of smoke billowing out. Almost like just a giant smokestack.
Have we seen the dawn?
Have you seen the dawn? The sun?
Is this a riddle?
Odd phrase.
Nope. Just a straight up question.
It is morning now, yes.
Alright.
You need to recharge your thing. Right?
Yes.
Recharge bunkers.
26 plus 4. So, it's full now.
You'll get at least a. What, 5? Alright, you guys can make your way to the valley thing.
Okay.
And you see ahead of you, let's switch up. There's a natural valley here next to the spire. And there is a mess of bodies in the middle of this kind of clearing. And currently there are two giant vultures picking over the remains, and there is a swarm of smaller birds kind of circling overhead, as if kind of waiting their turn. The giant vultures have not noticed you yet. You're about maybe 40 or 50 feet away from what looks like a carnage of bodies and skeletons and remains, just kind of all in a, not necessarily a neatly stacked circle, but kind of in a centralized area in the middle of this little natural indention.
Oh boy. Should we attack the vultures?
I don't know if we should attack them, but being D&D, I assume they will attack us. How large are these vultures?
They appear to be similar to the giant vultures that the knights were riding.
Okay.
So they are gigantic vultures. The birds swarming overhead do not appear gigantic.
Does anyone have animal vulture persuasion?
Speak to vultures.
Animal handling, but...
They haven't noticed you, and they don't look like they are particularly, like, you know, on watch or anything. They're just kind of rooting through the remains and having a snack.
It would be interesting to investigate the bodies. I assume these are victims of the air cultists, but I don't suppose we can be sure until we actually look at something.
Try to scare off the vultures.
Alright.
Intimidate them.
Kalnar runs towards the vultures, just screaming at the top of his
very
lungs.
Intimidating fashion.
Yes, just roaring.
Roll intimidation.
And he trips on a rock and falls in a hole.
Yeah.
I just care not for my...
The vultures appear momentarily startled, and then both of them kind of turn and flan out their wings and...
Well, are the vultures not... If the vultures aren't attacking us at all, we can just examine them with them in the area. It doesn't really... They don't care. We're...
You're going to have to roll for initiative now. You decided to roll up them and charge them.
You didn't follow up with that, so I thought, like, okay, well, we'll just...
I was switching the map over, but yeah, it's happening now.
Dear Lord, I'm terrible at rolling initiative. So is Talus. I don't feel bad.
Actually, rolled worse than you.
Whoops.
Did you? The damn rolled the worst.
Really shit the beds with those guys.
Critically failed that. Can they just, like, freak out for half a second and fly away?
This is their freak out. You guys get to all go first.
Someone roll for Tether.
Oh. I'm missing it.
What?
Wow.
Oh, look, there's another.
Can you see that?
What is
the Bloodhawk?
Oh, damn it.
Yeah.
Alright. That didn't work.
They know you're there.
Shit the bet on that initiative, didn't I?
Yeah.
You roll for... Yeah, what is up with my fucking initiatives? Holy crap. Critically failed on both of them. Kethra rolls. I can do it for him. That's what you get for having me roll your initiative. Apparently.
You did better. That's all we have.
Miri, 15 handily wins this initiative round.
I have to shrink the turtle and other things so I can find my person. 5, 10, 20, 25, 30, 35,
40.
Damn!
Wow. They are a ways away.
Man! I take that.
A dart!
Shitty bird.
The 10 will hit a giant vulture. It has no
armor. Wow, okay.
It is just a bird. For 6 piercing damage as you sink the dart right into its side. Talus?
Talus has glimpses of the future and thinks that there might be something else coming after them.
Damn it. Yeah, those birds overhead also appear to be angered by your intrusion.
Can I tell how many birds there are up there?
Yeah, I'll just look on the map. Whatever. Looks like there's about half a dozen of them.
Wow. Alright, we've kicked the proverbial hornet's nest.
Looks like a popular feeding ground. They are regularly sized birds, though.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to need a circle 20-foot radius.
Dear.
This is going to fucking murder.
This is usually Raven's job.
Oh, yeah.
Whoopsie. In a second circle. 20-foot radius. Does that mean 40 feet across?
Yes.
Yes.
I know, I'm working on it. 10, 15, 20.
This is MS Paint.
Basically. 40, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40. There's your 40 fucking foot circle. Where would
Excellent.
You like it?
Try to get as many of those things in.
Nature suddenly called.
Yeah. I think that's
right.
The best one I can do.
That looks perfect.
That's pretty good.
Thank you. Talus is going to give some of that good old bat guano that he had hidden away in his sleeve.
Oh no, the bat guano! Shield dries!
Give a little sniff. Add a sprinkle of sulfur. Too late, Raymond. Here, I rolled you a 5.
Yeah.
That 5.
And going to cast... Fireball!
Oh, boy! Yeah. That's going to be a lot of dead birds. All right, next save. For the vulture... And they're just trying to save for half damage. Top guy... Man, I started off well. And bottom guy. Alright, so top guy takes 24 damage.
Yep.
As it is on fire, that is massive damage for our friend.
Squawk.
Con save. Misses the con save. D10 is a 9. I know that one is the... Just can't take reactions, but... Does take a lot of damage. The second one does save, but he takes 12 damage, and because of Miri's earlier dart, it is melted into a pile of burning feathers.
See, y'all made fun of my dart.
And I'm not going to roll for the hawks, because half damage would kill them all. So they're all dead.
Just immolated birds.
Yeah.
In the future is awesome, guys.
It is. There's only one bird left.
Yeah, and the other vulture is still alive, just heavily burned.
Oh yeah, that guy.
All right. Holy Freyholes. Talonar is next.
Okay. What? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25.
Now this one is in the air.
Oh, he's in the air. Okay.
Yeah.
It's
probably... Let's see, what is the speed? He's probably a good... We're going to say it is 30 feet in the air.
Okay, I'm going to do this at a disadvantage, but he is going to toss a spear at that bird.
14 will hit that bird. And you successfully spear the bird from underneath, and it just falls to the ground. Oh no, it doesn't. That actually doesn't kill that bird.
Really?
That is a healthy-ass bird.
I'm going to take another spear and chuck it at the bird.
And that will definitely kill the bird. Yeah. Now, do you actually go through these spears? Do these have limited ammo?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I should have. Yeah.
I never keep track of y'all's ammo, so I assume you do that. So the Bloodhawks are dead. Kethra?
I'd like to shoot a crossbow at that vulture.
I will allow it. Well, we'll hit the vulture for 4 damage. Is not going to get anything done, though. Even though the vulture is extremely wounded, it looks like it is near death. And because of that, on its turn, it is going to immediately fly away.
If only Kethra had rolled a 5.
Yeah.
Well, you still get the experience for beating him. Since you technically defeated it.
Yeah.
This is the route, essentially. I'll go ahead and count that as an X. Alright. The way seems clear now.
Alright, let's go and examine some bodies.
Alright.
Investigation check, please.
Body examination!
Investigation.
So mad.
Nope. I'm going to go stand over here by the tree.
I did, though.
Kalinar, you know that these bones all seem to have... They're all humanoid, and they've all died from massive trauma, as if from a great distance. And they do all appear to have that air symbol carved into their skull.
The air symbol?
The air cult symbol thing.
Oh. Why would the air cultists be throwing their own people out of the tower?
You surmise that from what you've seen of other bodies, that they seem to do that to, like, as ritual sacrifices to others. They carve the symbol.
Oh, they're not actual cultists. They're, okay, they carve the symbol in their heads and then throw them off the tower. All right, that's fucked up. The remains of this cult's victims. If no one wants anything else with them, I suggest we burn the bodies so that these foul vultures no longer feast upon their remains.
Very well.
Always burning with you.
Mm-hmm. It's always burning with me.
Everything needs a good burning.
All right. Kalinar this time takes out a torch because it's more respectful than breathing fire.
More respectful.
And he does actually pour some oil on the bodies too, just to make sure they light.
Yeah.
And
the smell is horrifying.
That's not. I didn't clip that. So I must spoil the mask.
You can so get that torch out.
I wield the power of torch.
Use a torch. It's super effective. All right, with the power of oil and fire, the bodies burn gloriously. And no animal comes to harass you.
All right, I guess we should move on.
All right, you guys can link back up with the river pretty quickly after that. No more null families. Crosses
we'll
to about.
Murder them if there are.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's still probably not even noon yet because these are. I think it's what 250 feet thing, so it's not even close to a mile. And you guys head towards the gully. A narrow fissure in the canyon wall leads through a gully choked with pale brush and shrubs. A swift breeze passes through. The fissure as the river begins to narrow. The path continues. Or the canyon wall where a. Oops, hang on, I'm ahead. Yeah, the path narrows as the river seems to go towards the canyon wall. About. And you guys can, literally, there's canyon walls and then a river in the middle, so you would have to, like, trudge into the river, but the river is, like, knee deep at this point. It's just like a creek, basically. And it's narrowed to where it's, like 20 feet across? 10, 15, 20, 25, like 30 feet across. But it's, you can walk through it. It does count as difficult terrain, so it does double your movement to walk through. But and the visibility is really good, and about 50 feet up ahead, you recognize one of the monks that have been attacking you guys. The hurricanes. And it seems to be just kind of, and there's no real way for you to, like, stealthily go along. It's literally just canyon walls on both sides and then, like, the river. So you guys are, you can tell me what marching order you've got, but there's no real way to stealth forward. And he, you guys kind of see each other at the same time after, like, a brief little, like, fog lifts up ahead. And he kind of shouts a word of warning. And you see two other monks kind of run up from the darkened passage behind them as it enters, as the river enters the canyon wall. And we'll need to roll for initiative again.
Immediate fight. Yep. Best initiative roll I've made in a while.
Let's see if I can do terrible again. That's better. You guys all do good, though. Mary! So it does take double movement in the river. Assuming you're walking. 20,
30, 40. Close enough. Yeah, that guy. Okay. Pay attention to which guy?
The left guy.
There will be a test on this later. Aw, oh, damn it.
It's not the greatest water whip in the world.
Nope. Only thing I can hope for is he fails it.
Next save.
Nope.
Does save. So he takes four damage. Remember when a water whip the last session straight up killed one of them?
Yep.
That was insane.
Mary's ire is slowly fading.
Yeah, it seems to kind of quickly dodge out of the way of the bulk of the whip comes spinning around it. Kethra.
I am going to shoot a crossbow at the leftmost one.
Old lefty. Twelve is not going to hit him.
Damn, it's a terrible round.
So far, this is not going too well.
I'm going to move 10, 20, 30. Done.
Okay. Monks, leftmost one will whisper a few words and then get into a crescendo and then slam his hands together Hulk style. Create a gust of wind. Which is a 10 feet wide. I'm just going to keep it in the squares just to be easy. There's the gust of wind. So, Miri and Talus need to roll strength saving throws. 11 or higher.
That's the heart?
Yeah.
Yes. Double critical fails. You get pushed 15 feet back.
Map doesn't even go...
off the map.
Yeah, off the map.
Yeah, I'll just put you here. It's fine. As you get knocked backwards.
I hit some kind of invisible wall.
What's going on here?
Let's see, what's their movement? There. The rightmost one will do the same thing, also casting gust of wind.
It's gonna be an annoying fight.
Yeah!
And he's gonna put it back.
Do these winds affect projectiles of any kind?
You know, it doesn't say, but I would definitely impose disadvantage at the very least.
Even on spells?
Not on spells. If you're not in it, you don't have to roll the check or anything. But if you're trying to shoot a projectile that follows
like a firebolt.
Because it's magic, I don't think so. I'm thinking more like if somebody tried to shoot an arrow through, like, this hurricane, then that would probably be a problem. this one will just affect Kethra. So roll a strength saving throw, please.
Do I do it now, or it says the beginning of my turn?
Starts its turn the line. Oh, you're right, it is beginning of the turn.
Nice, I love respec up.
starts its turn on the line. Yeah, you're correct. So it doesn't affect you until your turn. I guess that makes sense. And the third one...
We'll just laugh.
We'll just laugh. Let's see here.
Laugh, mighty gusts of wind!
45, 5, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10. Alright, he's actually going to rump the middle. Oops, these things are too big.
That's what she said.
I can't. There we go. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30.
Wait, it's not double movement for them?
10, 20.
That's what you get for telling me.
You guess.
Can he jump in the wind and fly further?
You know what? He does have the wing wear, but unfortunately, I already said you guys can't just like jump up and do that because you go down 5 feet. So we'll say that he can't do that. So 10,
he probably blown away.
20, 30, 40. And let's see, what is that thing? 15-foot cube.
So now it'll be centered on Miri because Miri reminded him he could not just run through the water.
Yeah, the middle one will cast well, let's see, 5, 10, 15. Yeah, he's out of range of the other guys. He'll cast Thunder Wave, which is always localized on himself in a 15-foot cube. Which will hit Miri and nothing else, I believe. 10, 15, yeah.
I knew that was coming.
He's going to cast it at just level 1.
Played croquet earlier today. What'd he do? He launches my ball across the yard. I knew this was coming.
Con save, please.
For 7 damage.
For 7 damage. That's terrible.
I guess it was a 2d8.
Wow. I did.
You take 7 damage and you are pushed 10 feet away from the caster.
So one square.
At least you're out of the wind.
Yeah, it actually knocks you out of the wind.
That works for me.
7 thunder damage. Alright, that's the Hurricanes. Kalinar.
Okay. 10, 20, 30.
You could dash.
I could. Then I wouldn't be allowed to attack.
True. I could.
He is going. I still can't even make it. Ten, 20, 30. It's not very far.
Wind just like whiffing all around you.
Yep. Or constant by a train.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like in Jackal of Richard Gere in between two trains.
Yep.
Between two trains, the Kalinar story.
So, is this like a path I can walk on, by the way? Should I go over here?
This is the best map I could find, but I wanted to have it just pure river and then just walls on either side, so.
Okay, sorry.
So, are the two trains cocaine and heroin?
That's right. Kalinar is going to sludge the river 30 feet or 15 feet because he's like over fast. Then he's going to turn into a golden mist. And go 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30.
Oh boy.
So we're going to materialize next to the monk and bring his sword down.
Now that square is within the gust of wind, just so you're aware.
Yeah. So
it won't affect you. Right.
Now, my presumption, though, is that concentration applies to this, right?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So when I hit him twice, he's probably going to have to check that twice. Well, if I hit him twice.
Yep. Every time he takes damage, I think he has to do the con save.
Right. All right.
What did we figure that out? Was
I think it was 10 or half damage.
As the DC?
Whichever one's greater.
Okay.
Yeah.
16 will hit for 8 damage, so now he does the 10 DC 10.
Yeah, I can look it up to make sure, but I'm pretty sure it's it.
Is there 10 or half the damage taken?
Yeah, whichever one's higher.
Okay. 10 is higher than 4.
Yep.
Yes, it is.
He is able to keep concentrating.
Alright, then I lash out at him again.
Boy!
Oh boy.
5 will hit.
Yes, that is correct.
13 damage.
He 6 looks... is higher, not higher than 10.
Yeah, he'll have to make that save again. He does, barely. However, he looks extremely bloodied and beat up from that assault. Is that it?
All right. That's all I got.
Alice.
Seeing that he does look extremely bloody from that assault.
I don't know if you'd be able to know that.
Chalice can
lay down the river.
Divine it. It's fine.
I'll just wave it away as divining. He'll cast Magic Missile at the same guy Kalinar is attacking at level 1.
All right, all 3 darts pepper into the monk, and he goes down.
Nice.
But does he lose concentration?
Yes, he does. And the gust suddenly dies down, and the little creek stops swirling. Mary, oh, you need to roll your strength check, though. Your strength saving throw. You were still in the wind on the other side.
Okay. Okay.
You didn't start there, though, right?
Yeah, because we said he didn't get pushed back before.
Oh, he didn't?
He only now checks it.
Ah, okay.
Well, I assume the roll from earlier still counted, so...
That's fine, you can take that one.
Yeah. The magic missile range is 120 feet.
Jesus. Cover most battle maps.
Do your worst.
Mary?
Hey. So, is it still, like... double movement, like right here and right here.
Yes, and it's quadruple movement within the gust of wind if you enter that space, because that one also doubles movement, so I'm assuming those stack on top of each other, creating a terrifying way to move.
40. Gonna stay outside of that little wind tunnel. Take that.
Those darts are getting some use.
Yeah.
The lead guy, I assume. The guy that's...
Yeah, okay.
Concentrating. All right.
Do I get to attack twice if I threw a dart?
Yeah.
You should really just rename those to like throw it like daggers or throwing stars or something.
Yeah, that's true. Dart is such
but
a dumb name.
I imagine darts. Yeah.
6. Oh, I need to do concentration for all these. Hang on. The first one.
Yeah.
10 or higher, he makes it, and the second one does hit as well. Also makes it, but he does take damage from sick. You guys can concentrate, they just can't survive. This he looks fairly damaged from that dual dart assault. Kethra.
Can we shoot a crossbow at the middle guy? Or he was the middle guy.
The guy closest to you. 17 will hit, but he has deflect missiles, which I should have just done for the dart guy, shouldn't I? I don't know why I didn't do that.
You would take that one.
Crap. Obviously, dart's a missile.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
You just didn't think about it? You didn't see it
I didn't think about it. I didn't. Damn it. Hit by range weapon, reduce the damage by 1d10 plus 9, rolled a 1, reduces by 10. So yeah, he reduces it to 0, and he can catch the missile.
Wow.
As you shoot
plus 9.
Yeah.
He can... I don't know why I didn't do the damn darts. there's no rule for being able to like shoot it back or anything, so I'm just going to say he catches the missile and like crushes it in his hand or something dramatic. The hurricanes are next. So as a bonus action, he can move the gust, although it still has to emanate from him. But he'll move it there. Have a gust.
I'm going to take the phone call now, so just message me if I need to do something.
Alrighty. And then 10, 20, 30. He will strike at Kalinar with his double attacks.
Strike at me. Ineffectually.
13 and 16, nothing.
Yep.
Okay.
He slaps at your chest. Why won't you die?
This one will cast Thunder Wave, which in my calculations should hit Kalinar and Miri, but not the monk. The other monk. 15-foot cube.
A 15-foot cube, yeah. But...
emanating from him, so... and this time he's going to cast it at level 2.
Mike, can you draw the cube?
I can draw a cube.
I need verification that it is actually going to hit both of us, because you cannot be trusted.
Draw a cube. Let's see how big is this cube. The bad thing is I need to create like a central point on him, that would make it easier on me.
It's like a 30-foot cube.
Well, I'm thinking 5, 10, 15 from him, because it says it's centered on him. 10, 15, 5, 10, 15, like that.
I'll give it to you. Alright. You cannot be trusted, so.
I have made mistakes in the past. No question. Level 2, Thunder Wave. There, it's meta damage. Constitution saving throws, Kalinar and Miri.
Boy.
Wow. I'll take... both of you made it with flying colors. Take 8 damage, and you are not pushed away. And a thunderous boom echoes throughout the canyon. Kalinar.
Kalinar will swing at the guy right in front of him. Levin's probably not gonna do it.
No, it's not.
He swings again. Will a 24 do it?
It will. You take a deep, deep gash right into his like side and neck and shoulder. Kind of has to clutch the wound as it's gushing. Still on his feet though.
And as the wound gushes.
Now on Lifetime, as the wound gushes.
Kalinar takes out his heroin.
Golden light will spread down the blade. 2d8. With 2d8 more damage.
Wow.
11 more!
Alright. The golden light spills over the... or I guess you still stab him with a melee weapon.
Yeah, it's actually
the wound from the melee weapon suddenly glows brightly and hot, and he like screams as it seems to like melt him, and he dies. As does the wind tunnel. Alice.
A little fatigued from casting that firebolt earlier. Alice decides to cast a smaller
magic
version.
Missile.
Fireballs?
Perfect!
That is a miss! For no damage! Ah, we're back to normal. That's our talus. Mary!
10... 20. One...
hit.
Two.
Seven. That will hit. You do a 1-2 pummeling punch with the mace.
Three.
And that will miss. You try to come up, and he finally dodges out of the way quickly. He has taken some damage and appears injured. Kethra. Dashing, okay. Is that okay, bonus action dash? Boy. 20 is a hit, and 18 is... Yeah, he managed to find a sweet spot in his ribs and sink it in there, and he gives a shudder but doesn't fall, but appears extremely near death. Is 18 massive damage. I have to do math real quick. 18 is massive damage. So... fails the con save. D10. 8. That's one of the not bad ones for me. Yeah, I can't take reactions at the end of his next turn. So he's still up. And it's his turn, so he will cast Thunderwave again. This time catching more people.
Yep.
He's got... Let's see, what has he done? He did Thunderwave at level 1, and then Thunderwave at level 2, so he can do another level 2 one. That's pretty much the only good spell he's got.
They don't actually punch. Or they do punch. He tried to punch me. 7 damage.
Yeah, they
do
punch.
Not great.
No, it's not. That was level 2 also. That was a 2d8 plus 1. Plus 1d8? That's awful. Alright, con saves for Miri and Kalinar and Kethra. So you can take half of 7 damage.
We're going to take 3 damage. We have to roll for Kethra.
Sure he doesn't take that full damage.
That extra 4. Nope.
Alright. So, I'll put that down on his... Well, it's, yeah, 3. So it's 3 damage you guys take, right? Rounds it down?
Yes. Yeah, 3 damage.
Mm-hmm. Alright, Kalinar.
Kalinar... 10, 20, he can reach him in this fucking river. I need to re-roll that 1d10.
6 is definitely going to hit.
Let me re-roll it. I'll re-roll the whole thing.
1d10 plus. You don't need to. It would kill him anyway.
Oh, okay.
He was very near death after Kethra's attack. As you come up and give him the final, like, you practically just shove him over into the water, and he finally just breathes out his last.
Kalinar knocks him down, puts his foot over his face, and just drowns him.
Oh, God, that's messed up.
I like it.
Alright, those appear to be the only adversaries here, and like the other monks you've faced, they don't have anything on them. These guys don't even have the wing wear on them.
Wow. Alright.
The river to the north narrows even further as it enters a canyon wall where a natural overhang creates a gloomy entrance. The path continues for several dozen feet as a cool wind picks up. Suddenly your progress is halted by a thick grate that spans the length of the opening, a network of thick bars leaving only tiny holes for wind to pass through. You don't see any natural lock or opening.
Ha. Huh. So it's just a grate into the rock.
Should we try to bend the metal to get through?
Yeah, I can try to just bash it down. I've got a ram. A portable ram that I have not used yet. Should I try to do that? Just bash it?
Sure.
I have a better idea.
You're just perceiving the door.
So what?
We just perceive that at first.
Yeah.
You can investigate. Use an investigation.
Okay. Last time I investigated, I got a 4, so.
I'd do much better, and I have a +7.
Did awful.
Talus, you find nearby, carved in the stone, the air cult symbol. And the bars, you feel a you can tell that they are not, they don't appear to be natural, like they're like untouched by wind and water.
If everyone has 10 minutes, I can do detect magic.
Well, we don't have a whole lot else we can do here, right? Except for bashing at it, probably ineffectually. So, sure.
Alright. Talus is going to mutter a few words for 10 minutes over and over again.
Give me a second to type it out for you.
Oh, it was just far away.
It was. I'm back. Sorry.
I think it's coming through Heather's microphone. Wait, her microphone's off.
My bad. Sure, I sounded strange for a while.
I thought we're still on break.
We're now coming back from break. Apparently OBS didn't crash. I think it just froze for a second, so I guess we're still on.
Nice.
So as I was saying, I bumped you out to this map. I assume you guys are exiting the Sighing Valley. I think you've done everything of interest in there.
Except, you know, the one thing.
So the thing we couldn't do.
Yeah, except an important thing you need to remember about, so if you want to put that in your notes somewhere.
Put in notes.
Okay. I guess missing delegation, I suppose. Since where all the notes go.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, there's that Sacred Stone Monastery just right to the right of where we're going. We're at. There's we discussed this last week, and I'm trying to remember what we said. Mm-hmm. Essentially, I think we said we could head towards like the main points of interest. We could head towards Summit Hall by going north through Sumber Hills. We can head towards Wumford, south through on the Cairn Road to Wumford to investigate that lead that Talus had. We could hit the Sacred Stone Monastery.
Let's hit the Sacred Stone Monastery.
Okay.
It's right there.
We are close, yes. This was, if I remember correctly, this was the guy who was calming the town, right? This is where he was from?
Oh, yeah, that guy.
That's where he learned the location, yes.
But he said he was from there, if I remember correctly,
yes.
Right?
Yeah. Correct.
Okay. He was trying to, like, buy his way back in or something like that?
Mm-hmm. Larocque, was an exiled member of the Sacred Stone Monastery.
Okay. So we don't necessarily know... We don't know if these guys are bad guys, necessarily.
Right.
We don't really know much about them.
The DM is pleased with the decision. This is the one I spent the most time on. So there's no road here, so it takes you guys a good long time to try to just traverse a hilly region, essentially. It gets to be about midday, afternoon. You can find... You know, you're not literally scaling cliffs or anything, but it does take you a while. There's no natural wide path to go on. You are trudging along through the barren countryside when you hear a low, distant rumbling. A moment later, the ground beneath your feet begins shaking. The tremor is strong enough to start small slides of pebbles from the hillside and cause shrubs and brush to wave from side to side, and then it subsides. A moment later, horrible insect-like creatures as big as horses begin to burrow out of the ground.
What?
Go on.
Yeah.
I wasn't prepared for this.
Me either. I'm only at 20 hit points.
Oh boy.
Ooh, I do have a potion of animal friendship, though.
It's probably beyond animal friendship at this point. Please, there you go.
that would have been the vulture speak thing we were talking about.
Yes.
Vulture speak.
Man, I've been doing really bad on initiative. I guess extremely average.
Extremely.
Extremely slightly below average.
Hello.
Well, that's not good.
So there's no surprise round because you guys kind of felt the lumbering happen, although the insects certainly shocked you. Yeah, since me and Miri tied, let's each roll a 1d20.
Alright, I'm back.
Whoever goes, gets higher, goes first. That would be Miri.
You win with a 10.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's just...
Make sure they're not enemies. See if they're friendly.
They talk to them. Yeah, they appear to be just giant. I don't know how exactly big they are.
They look like ultralisks.
Yeah. They're slightly more insect-like, but yeah, basically are that. Let's see, 15 and 15. Those are both going to hit, actually.
Oof.
For 17 damage, that's pretty solid.
Take a good suck ass.
Crunches. Man! In the four. Alright, it appears quite injured after that assault. Chunks of chitin coming out of its legs. That's how chitin works, right?
It's possible, sure.
Giant magic creature chitin. We haven't heard enough of this combat music, have we?
Nope.
Alright, next is the Ankh eggs.
Yeah, it's sort of like cutting off your skin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If your skin was also your bones.
Right.
30 feet long, 5 foot. Alright, they're gonna spray acid.
Why are these things standing up against under the weight of their own exoskeletons? That's what I want to know.
Hey, quiet you. let's see.
Gravity is lighter in the D&D world.
So do these require what kind of attacks are these?
Hang on. These are going to be this is a saving throw.
Okay.
I'm trying to think how I want to do this. I need a line. How do you draw a line?
Shapes.
Polygon line. Five, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Alright, that's the length of its acid spray.
It's a decent line.
That's what I'm trying to figure out. It can be 5 feet wide. So he can spray it like this and cover you guys in a line.
That's probably not good.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out before I start rolling who am I catching in this. And then he's going to have to move more if he wants to spray without hitting.
Yeah, make him hit his partner.
His buddy, yeah.
The bug, they don't know anything.
Crossfire!
It's going to basically spit this way and hit that group, and then the third one will not spit. Alright, so here's the total one. We're going to do, well, I'll do this one first. So 5 foot wide, this is like the rightmost edge of it. That makes sense. And the left edge, I don't think it'll catch Talus in there now, because it's already in this one. Talus will be just outside of it. Alright, here's the acid spray. It's a DC 13 dexterity saving throw for half damage.
Oh boy.
It spits acid. So Miri, Kalinar, and Kethra all kick acid saving throws.
Right.
I don't.
No. So Miri and Kethra take 7 damage, and Kalinar takes 14 acid damage.
Can I uncanny dodge it?
I don't know if you. Maybe. It's not an attack, but it is a sort of an attack.
Wait, what?
All out.
You can half uncanny dodge it.
So that'll be 3 damage.
I'm taking 14.
Yes.
Balls.
Yes. That's one of their. So that's the lower left guy's turn, and then this one will acid spray you three.
Okay.
For 13 acid damage. And same thing, gotta roll 13 higher dex saving throw. This time it's Talus, Kalinar, and Kethra.
Alright, I got that one.
Kethra and Kalnar take 6 acid damage.
Well, my dodge still applies, right?
Does it last for the turn?
I think it's
per attack.
Reading the description, like, it looks like it's an attack.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess it's like attack of opportunity. You only do it once, right?
Yeah.
Right.
But you only get the one reaction.
Right. Okay. 6 damage.
And Talos takes the full 13. And then the Ankh-Egg will just attack Miri. With its bite. Nineteen.
Wow.
Wait, why does this have a save on it?
Because he tries to grapple you in his claws. You might want to dodge that shit.
Why?
No, that's true. It only does the disadvantage. Yeah.
No, 19 kills me. Like the 13 plus the 3, I'm dead.
16.
16.
Yeah, I'm dead. More than what my hit points are.
I think I had 20, or he hit you with something else earlier, didn't he?
Yeah, the acid from earlier.
Oh, boy.
So I'm at negative 3. All right.
Talos, do you have a say about that, or do you want to let her go down?
I mean...
No, it doesn't matter about the save. I'm at negative 3.
No, he doesn't. He can do any number.
It has to be done before the attack.
Well, if you want to do it, I'll let you do that. Well, we've done that before.
Alright. Talos wakes up from his slumber.
No! He was slumbering? He just got burned by acid.
This is all wrong.
This is not what happened.
He didn't get hit by acid. Miri didn't go down. Oh, wait, he did get hit by acid. Why was he asleep? He's burning to death. Oh, God, it hurts so much. Yeah, the Ankh actually rolled a 6.
A 6.
And completely whiffed. Even though he had a look of victory in his eyes.
Out of, yeah. Kalnar.
Oh, I don't have it. I don't believe I have any potions or anything. I do not. Alright.
Have lay on hands?
Yeah, but that's my full action. And I'm not comfortable standing in between three. Oh.
Can I just throw a potion to Myriad then? Right now, or do I have to wait?
If you're throwing something, that's going to be an action.
So 5, 10, 15, 20. I'm going to swing at this Ankh-Egg. It's a 14 hit? Or no, 27.
27 will hit. And 15, you nearly take the beast's legs off, and it stumbles a bit. Still upright.
Alright. Swing in for 28.
Oh boy, and a 19. You plunge your sword into the beast's thorax. It gives off a skittering cry and then kind of crumples to the ground. Just did a shit ton of damage to him. A 15 and a 19.
Yeah.
Dallas.
And.
Oh, sorry.
Hold on. I got a bonus action.
Hold on.
Bonus action. Oh, ho, ho.
As a bonus action, I'm going to cast Shield of Faith on myself. And 5, 10 more points of movement. All right. Now I'm done.
Talos will cast a new and improved, correctly spelled mirror image. And run up to this Ankh-Egg. And go booga booga booga!
okay, Kethra.
I'm going to use my bonus action to disengage from this guy on the left. So 5, 10, 15.
Because the Hulk is currently distracted by Talos' Book of Book of Maneuvers.
From a rapier sneak attack.
25 for 17 damage. Pretty solid. That is not quite massive damage. But you do take a good... It screeches in pain. You stab into its backside. What you approximate is its backside.
This has a backfire. Move here. In the hopes that they will not acid each other.
Nice. I think both of them actually cast acid, though.
Yeah, but now if they try to hit me, then they'll just hit each other.
If they have another one. Well, yeah. I don't know. They may not have an. I don't know how many charges that they have.
You don't.
That's our recharge 6.
Hmm.
Yeah, what that means is I roll a d6 at the start of their turn, and if I roll a 6, they get it back.
Oh, well, that's too bad.
So, it's pretty hard to do. Well, 1 in 6, I guess, chance every turn.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're back to them. This one will attack Kethra. It's unfazed by the Booga Booga.
What?
And do a terrible job.
That's right. Yeah, he's still thinking about the Booga Booga.
I forgot to roll the recharge, didn't I? Recharge that one I already took his turn on. He does not get it back. Now recharge the second one. He does get it back.
Boo.
He'll run up here and acid spray straight to the right.
Oh.
And get Talus and Kalinar.
God damn it. Alright.
Some good rolls in these acids.
Yeah. With dexterity? Is that what it was?
Yeah.
Fuck. Goddamn.
So does this do anything different with duplicates?
Do the duplicates help you on saving throws at all?
Oh, no, they don't. Oh, it's just like I roll to see if the attack hits me or my duplicates.
That rule can still apply, that's fine. Because he was still trying to aim it along the line, so we can say that he might have accidentally aimed at a duplicate instead of you.
Okay. Alright.
Connor, you don't have a whole lot of life, sir.
No, I don't. I have 2 hit points.
I can't even see your health bar right now.
It hits one of my duplicates.
Okay.
I have 2 duplicates.
Does it melt that one, I assume?
Yes.
Alright. That's me. Mary?
Hey. Whoops. What the hell?
Boxes! She cast boxes!
She cast boxes! Super effective.
Geometry, no!
The Alkeg's only weakness. Geometric shapes.
Just takes him to the negative zone.
Oof.
That was a solid crunch.
2.
God damn.
Wow.
Another solid crunch. Swing and a miss. Okay, appears quite injured. Kalinar
is undeterred by his bloodied state. Must finish the creatures.
He becomes zombie Kalinar.
That's right.
He's so literally just trailing his entrails behind him. Shoving parts of his intestine back into his stomach. Man, 28 will hit.
I have to re-roll that damage, the first damage, because it's a 2. Hmm. Is that 1d10 plus 4 plus 1, so it's 1d10 plus 5. So that's 8 plus 11. 19!
19 is exactly what you need to finish this creature off.
Nice. So that was
crush
10.
Into it with a critical pirouetting side slash.
15, 20, 25.
Wow.
He swings again! For 12.
12 will not hit.
Do I have anything I can do with my bonus?
Was that? What about your cleave?
Oh, that, you're right, I killed a guy. Yeah, so I get a cleave attack. Yes.
Brick killed a guy.
There's your cleave.
22 will hit for 12. This one appears extremely wounded. Not unlike Kalinar and Miri. Talus.
Back up right there. Oh, right there. There's so many potential lines.
The lines, the lines.
He'll cast the one thing he knows will hit.
Bonk.
He throws the staff.
Ranged bonk.
12.
This time,
force damage.
His duplicates will cast at the same time, and most of the darts will be ineffectual.
Yeah. The darts slam into the beast, and it appears to reel backwards, and this gushes of insect blood comes out. Still, however, rights itself, but it is like clawing at the ground in pain.
Wow.
Kethra.
Finish it.
24 for 16 will absolutely finish it. She neatly slides. Actually, she's crawls up the side in a Legolas move and just like slices its neck.
Like another little bug.
And then hops right down. Yeah. Down go the Ankh eggs. The world is still, once again, unsure if the creatures were driven mad by the earthquake or were caused by the earthquake, or whatever else. But the danger has subsided. They have nothing.
I need a nap.
I do lay on hands on myself. 25.
I touch myself after this fight.
Just slowly move his hand towards his chest. Do you have a healing potion, Mary?
I have one. And okay. Now I have zero. All
right, take mine. I forgot
what
one.
Is it?
2d4
plus
2.
2?
Okay. You have one of mine.
Why, thank you.
Yeah. Talus has been hoarding health potions over there.
Yeah.
People are dying left and right. He's like, I guess I can give you one of my 17 health potions. I'll have to make this necklace later.
Oh, man. Hey, that one. Okay.
That was better. Yeah. These health potions are not adding up like they used to.
No.
Yeah.
And as far as I'm aware, there's no such thing as a greater healing potion. I don't know. You guys are supposed to have healing services now.
Right. We're supposed to be able to heal.
Or lots of health potions. I don't know.
Get their ass, Miri. Do you need another potion?
No, I'm okay.
Okay. Phew. You really want to give one away?
It'll cost 5,000 gold.
Knowing that jerk.
Let's see. And I have a picture to go along with it as well.
Ooh.
A trail leads into an ever-narrowing defile between bluffs of wind-sculpted sandstone. Eventually, the walls drawn so closely that you can reach out and
touch them?
Touch either side. But then the narrow space opens into a hidden canyon in the heart of the hills. A sprawling monastery with dark, narrow windows and red rooftops. I meant to show this while I was talking about this. Artist's rendition of what this might look like. A sprawling monastery with dark, narrow windows and red tile rooftops stands in the middle of this natural amphitheater, ringed by sandstone cliffs all around. Ahead, a weathered flight of stone steps leads up to the closed monastery doors. The plain doors are made of heavy timber with iron studs. A dusty footpath circles the building.
Okay. Let's slowly approach the building.
Roll for initiative.
Arrows come flying at you from all directions.
Yeah. What are you just approaching it?
Yeah.
The building does not respond.
Do I get up to the front door?
If you wish.
I knock on the front door.
Okay. Lightly or heavily?
A normal...
Roll a strength check.
A small panel in the monastery's front door slides open, and someone wearing a golden mask peers out. The mask is fashioned in the shape of a scowling gargoyle, but the hand that opens the panel seems human enough. From beneath the mask comes a female voice. Yes, what do you want?
We are adventurers seeking some waylaid ambassadors through these lands. We encountered an exiled priest of yours in a nearby town attempting to exploit the villagers there. Larocque? Does that name mean anything to you?
She studies you for a moment and says, what do you wish?
We are searching for leads, to be honest. We're not sure where to look. We're hoping to find some answers here.
She says, you'll find none here, and shuts the door rather rudely. Shuts the panel.
Alright, guys, let's go home.
Roll a perception. Perception check.
Sure. What are you perceiving exactly?
I guess the door.
It looks sturdy and door-like. It has iron bands on the outside. You imagine it does lock up.
We should fly in.
Kill them all?
No! Just say surprise when we land.
Oh, okay. And they won't try to kill us all, you think?
Who knows?
Let's see. What did Larocque give us some information that would be helpful here? Let me see.
Talk to her about the air clan. Or something.
Alright. I'm knocking on the door again.
The panel slides open again. She says, yes.
Let's go with this a different direction, shall we? Can't tell if it's a male or female voice?
Female.
It's a female voice.
Let's go with this a different direction, shall we, ma'am? Are you familiar with the air cultists who exist in the valley to your west?
She studies you for a long moment and says, what about them?
Are they friend or foe to you?
Studies you for a moment longer. Says, what business do you have with them and with us?
They...
I see that you wear their wings.
Wings.
Have they sent you here?
Say yes.
Say yes?
No.
They have not, though we have come from their dwelling. I assume you've seen the smokestack to the west.
What has happened?
The air cultists have...
They're playing back in Kalinar. This happened.
The air cultists kidnapped one of the ambassadors that we seek to rescue. And in the process of attempting to rescue that ambassador, they attacked us, and the smoke you see to your west is the result of that attack.
You destroyed them?
They're...
Yes. Holy crap.
We did. The tower is no longer present.
She suddenly steps away from the panel, and you hear some, like, murmuring inside. And then the door suddenly opens in front of you.
That was quite a gamble we took. Are they actually with them or not?
Scroll all the way down and to the right.
Would you have actually lied, though, if I told you?
Probably not. Yeah, I probably wouldn't have straight out lied. Lied about it. Still a gamble, though.
Sure.
Alright, so the door does open.
Alright, can I do... Would a religion check do anything?
Go for it. Let me description real quick. This austere hall is finished in irregular blocks of dark basalt that form natural columns along the walls. The doors of the monastery's front entrance face south, while interior doors lead east and west. And you can see there are little windows. An interior courtyard lies just to the north of this room, visible through a pair of narrow windows. And the female monk says, very well. Carbo will wish to hear of this. Follow me and stick closely. Do not deviate from the path.
Okay.
Alright. The two of them. One of them leads, and the other one kind of waits expectantly to kind of bring up the rear. Eastern door.
Talos would like to study the one right next to him.
Stare at her uncomfortably.
I'm gonna put you guys in a little bit of a line so I can move you easier. So you guys move along.
Whoop.
So many doors to open.
That's what Kevin sees.
And, stops right there. You guys hear general kind of voices and of a kind of building that's got people in it. You hear the sounds of like fighting, but it sounds like sparring. Not like bloody vicious fighting, but definitely like people either practicing or dueling or something nearby. And open up. Door. Oops. Click on that. Eight. Lead you guys through here. This long, narrow court is paved in red sandstone. To the north stands the main temple or shrine of the monastery. Its copper sheathed doors emblazoned with a triangular symbol that is somewhat familiar to you all.
Oh dear. Okay.
Because it looks like... Oops. This.
Yep.
Doors also exit at the court in its south, its east and west end. Several narrow windows placed on the south wall. And four gargoyle statues guard the door, each facing the court with a ferocious leer. you guys along. It's actually a pain in the ass trying to get all your tokens. And then she opens the door up ahead.
Does she open it with keys, or does she just open it?
She just opens it. There we go, I can get all of you in there. Kind of leads you up to about right here. Alright, four large columns of natural rock dominate this shrine. A wide set of steps descends into darkness in the center of the room, in front of a slab-like stone altar. Large copper-sheathed doors stand in the middle of the south wall, and smaller doors exit to the east and west. Two narrow windows in the north wall admit thin fingers of light from outside. Above the altar, a triangular symbol has been chiseled into the heavy stone blocks of the wall. That same symbol. And then a robed figure adorned with the same gold-tinted gargoyle mask and looking basically in the exact same uniform as Larocque regards you coolly from behind the altar. He's flanked by a pair of stone-armored guards you recognize from the bandit toll on the road. And he kind of looks up expectantly, and the female figure says, actually, she leaves you guys there and kind of walks around and appears to whisper some things to Carbo. And then he nods and says some things back. And she goes back this way. He opens his arms in like a welcoming gesture and says, well, seeing as how this isn't a popular tourist location, there are only two reasons you've come to the Sacred Stone Monastery. Let's have it then. Do you see yourselves as potential servants of the Eternal Earth?
Servants, no. But we might yet be allies in some form or fashion.
Yes, been told that you are responsible for the smoking ruin that is now the spire, home of those filthy knights and their birds.
Indeed we are. And my understanding is that their kind and yours share no love for each other.
You are correct in this. Tell me, what involves you in these affairs?
I will speak bluntly, sir. We seek an ambassador that was traveling through the lands. I believe at one point you held her captive. As you might not be aware, I am a servant of Tyr, and thus an adherent to justice in all forms.
However, oh, hell, here we go.
However, in this case, we have very little evidence of your crimes, and yet all the evidence of the Air Cultist crimes. We seek only to rescue this ambassador, who I believe that the Air Cultists still hold. I believe that our paths align in this. For any attempt we make at rescuing this ambassador, will surely lead to more destruction of the Air Cultists you loathe so much.
Enough talk, let's kill him.
Says, yes, I can see why these paths would align quite nicely. Well, here's what I can do for you, Paladin of Tyr. You and your friends can meet with our leader in the hall below. I am echoing really bad. Is that what's happening?
It's probably because I'm leaning backwards.
And, yep, I think that did fix it.
Wow.
Yeah. I will not bar your passage here, and if you can confer with the Abbess of Stone, that maybe we can come to some kind of agreement in their mutual destruction.
Perhaps.
Gestures to the stairs in front of him.
Oh. Are we expected to go down?
Yeah.
All right.
Are we headed down? None of them are attacking you, so. If, I don't know if you were waiting for that.
Do you know of any magical keys that might open the magical lock over by the river? Just wondering.
It says, it's possible we may have recovered something in our battle with the air cults. You'll have to speak with the Abbess.
Wow, alright, thanks.
Where do you happen to keep it, by the way?
He waves his hand annoyingly. Below, below, you'll find them below.
Alright, let's go below.
We're going in!
Alright, as you guys go down the stairs, you see Carbo suddenly dash to the side of the wall and pull a lever, and the stairs beneath you suddenly become a ramp.
Of course it does.
As you guys slide down, you will need to all roll dexterity saving throw, please.
I really know I shouldn't pull this lever, but when are we going to be here again?
Does my slow fall protect me from... when I fall?
It'll protect you from taking any damage. And I'll give you advantage on the saving throw.
You didn't need it.
Yeah. Alright. So put you guys like. Let's see. How did you guys enter the stairs? Trying to figure out where you guys were.
Line.
In a line.
Sort of a horizontal line.
Kalinar and Talus, you guys land prone on your stomachs, basically, and fall over as the stair turns a ramp, and you hear a cackling sound coming from above.
Traitorous cur!
It is very dark down here. You might have to scroll to the right.
Oh, I see my token in blackness.
Okay.
The token is all I see.
Let me create some light source real quick, because it would be coming from the top a bit, at least.
I think I only... probably don't want to see what's down here.
Yeah.
You know, the one time I tried diplomacy instead of just kill them all, the one time I try it...
Yes. This is what happens.
You're driving Kalinar further into his extremism. I just want you to know that, Dia.
Extremism. Alright, we'll say that there's at least a light source there.
You can't admit you're evil. You're just extreme.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, so at the same time that the stairs turn into a ramp, these bars on the left side begin to raise, and a creature gives off a terrifying sound.
Run to the right.
I use my potion of animal friendliness.
The floor of this large chamber consists of loose red earth. A column of natural stone stands near the middle of the room, and a row of sturdy iron bars with a sliding cage door walls off the western portion of the room, which is now raising. A door of iron plate stands in the western wall behind the iron doors, while a similar door exits to the east. To the south, a wide set of stairs, now ramp, leads back up. Behind the iron bars stands a monstrous creature that resembles a cross between a huge ape and a beetle. It has wicked mandibles, powerful claws, and four eye sockets, but two of its eyes have been put out, and its claws have been removed and replaced with artificial bronze blades.
What?
The creature bellows and thrashes in rage, and as the bars open up, it charges at you.
This is the closest thing D&D is going to... It's the closest thing D&D is going to get to a cyborg monster.
Cyborg monster.
Can I throw my potion of animal friendship at it?
That's not how that works, I'm pretty sure.
Be my friend.
Crashed.
Love me.
Oh, Lord, I am not at full health either. I am at half health.
I'm about half, too.
You guys began this dungeon in a great spot, so that's what you're telling me.
Whose idea was it to go to the monastery?
I don't remember.
Alright, so two of y'all have to spend, let's see, Talus and Kalinar, you guys have to spend half your movement to stand up from being prone. Okay. But Kethra gets to go first, so these bars have now risen.
Well, the other way. 5, 10...
Sorry, not the bar. There's a cage door right here. This white part is the part that opened.
Oh, okay.
20, 25. Can I open the door?
What door?
He's just going to leave you guys to die.
There's a door here, right?
There is a door there, correct.
Does it open?
Let me figure out. I didn't expect you to open that door. Let me see if it's locked.
What?
What if there's more stuff behind there?
I'm taking the chance.
Alright.
He's panicking.
It is not locked, but the door is stuck. It will require a strength check.
I'm going to use my action.
Alright, so...
He's just freaking out.
There could be most likely creatures wanting to kill us behind there. Or us.
Yeah,
or something in there that will help us?
He's the only one that can properly see. And the fact that he's running is just fantastic.
Alright, strength check. It's too late. I've already committed to this action. I can't go back.
I want to see.
You're committed now.
He's come panic. He's already...
Wow. Oh, crap. You fucking crash into that door and knock it down.
Keep on running.
In just a fearful rage.
And 30.
Appears to be a small hallway with another door at the eastern side.
No, that was my action. I guess I could dash, but I can't open another door, right?
I guess you got your bonus action left, right?
Yeah, but even if I get to the door...
Right.
Well, that's okay.
So you can only use your bonus action to either dash or hide or disengage.
As Kethler breaks through the door, she yells, "Follow me!" And dashes another 30
feet.
We can't
see you!
5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30.
She just fucking takes off.
Which, to our eyes,
some of you are still on your stomachs having fallen down, and she just fucking ran out of the room.
Into the shadows, just into the dark. We don't.
Just into the dark.
We're just laying there expectantly, hearing like a twang of a bow or something, but it doesn't come. Instead, we just hear a crashing of a door.
That's the end of my turn. That's the end of your turn. Yep.
I guess can I light a torch and throw it to like right here so we can light up the rest of the room?
That would be your action to throw it.
That's fine. Okay, that's not...
Yeah,
that's perfect. Okay.
Where did Mary go?
I'm right here.
Yeah, I meant Kethra.
Are we running? Did we just run after Kethra? Although both Dallas and I are going to
You all roll the sixes, so I'll do the same thing where I'll roll a 20 and figure out where the order is.
Are both of y'all prone?
They are prone.
Yes.
I'll spend half the movement getting out.
Five. Ten. I'll just stand in front of Kalinar to protect my two fallen comrades. Just in case the other guy gets to go first.
Alright, so...
But if he doesn't, it'll all be for naught.
I know. I can pull a Kethra and leave you all
but
behind, but...
If he, well, yeah. Yeah.
Damn it, Kethra.
Well, maybe his door is...
I can't with the escape route.
Maybe the door is narrow and we can just sort of choke point this monster.
But we can't leave Miri behind.
Well... Yeah, we can, because she goes before the Umber Hulk, so she'll be able to run away.
But not this turn.
Well, yeah.
Alright, so you guys roll... Everybody, Chris and Reese, you guys roll 1d20.
1d20? Okay.
Uh-oh.
That's uh-oh, indeed.
See? Now you're happy, I say.
Well, the same
that
order
doesn't matter, because now the Umber Hulk is going to attack whoever he's going to attack, and then we're all going to run away anyway.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, I'm going to reserve my bonus action that I have to duck, step on the wind and run away at any given point that I want.
So because it's partially blinded, it does not have the Umber Hulk's trademark Confusing Gaze ability.
Good.
But the artificial blades
is,
look
but...
even more powerful than its normal claws.
Oh.
Is that a door behind it?
That is a door behind it.
Oh, there we go. 10, 15,
20.
Mary. Oh, wait, fine. Where's it going?
It's going to go right there.
Great.
And it is going to do terrifying things.
I'm sure it will.
I'm sorry about this already. It makes three attacks.
Oh, wow. Alright. Talos, do you have any dice left?
This is going to determine whether or not he sleeps on the couch tonight, by the way.
I mean, I can guarantee he hits one.
Flame Kethra for running away. That's my one saying.
Oh boy.
Two with its claws and one with its mandibles. No. It ferociously shrieks and claws and tears.
So that's going to be, I assume, 19 damage.
Mm-hmm.
Dear sweet
wow,
Lord.
It actually rolled kind of shit for damage, too.
Oh.
The ones that hit were the red.
That hurt.
Are you still alive?
Barely. I am coughing up blood.
Are we going to fight this thing? Do we have to fight this thing at this point?
I mean, I can try to gaze it, but that comes down to a wisdom check.
Wait.
You still have your dodge?
Yes, I do. Wait, I have patient defense. So I will take the dodge. So until the start of my next turn, any attack roll, because I still have my
should
bonus
be a
action.
Button.
I did mention this.
Can't confirm.
Can confirm. You readied the bonus action. Or I guess you took it.
Yes.
I did take it, yes. I mentioned this.
Disadvantage if you can see them. Yeah.
So
that should negate
the six. So I get 6 points back.
There you go.
Okay.
Mandibles came in and took a chunk out, but both claws missed.
Okay. Sorry.
Kalinar.
Oh, okay, let's fight it. Let's fucking fight this thing.
So that takes half your movement to stand up.
Oh, okay. So it's half my movement. So I have 15 points left.
Yeah.
Five. I can't actually do an advantage position. Okay. Yeah, I can misty step.
Well, but that's your Either way.
That's my bonus action at that point. But that's
he's
not
running
worth,
away
worth,
from this. He's gonna die or not.
It's worth it's worth having the advantage, I think.
Yeah. I sent Misty Step on the other side of him.
Yeah, so I'm gonna Misty Step.
Or do you may try to hypnotize him.
You do that too, yeah.
Well, I can't now.
Oh, well, really?
I guess I still could. It's a cube.
Well, you can hypnotic gaze me. Yeah, I don't care. I assume you're not gonna do terrible things to me.
I love the gaze. Gaze.
Hal and I might become far more enjoyable to have around if you.
I mean, the problem with that logic is if he gets his saving throw and you don't.
That's a good point. You could use your divination die to.
Oh shit! We just lost the internet. Oh dear. Terrible timing. No. The end of this fight would be a good time. Come on, internet. Oh, yeah. Well, I wish you guys hadn't have been super wounded already, but... Alright. Coming back from catastrophic internet failure. Hey. And then OBS crashed, of course, so that'll make me have to re-edit this thing, which is awesome.
That was my redo damage, so I did 13 damage to him.
Oh. Okay. Last thing I got was the 22-27 hit.
Yeah.
Okay.
19's not a crit, right? I guess it's just 20.
A natural 20, yeah.
Yeah.
Alright, 27 will hit, of course. And you did how much, 13?
13 damage.
Alright.
And I attack again. Well, 17 hit?
17 does not hit. It is a thickened carapace.
Oh. We're getting the hell out of here.
Yeah.
Talus.
Talus is freaking out.
You have a green square. Talus is freaking out.
As much as he wants to study this creature, he's also equally worried that it'll slice him in half. He's going to cast Hypnotic Gaze. Nah.
Okay. Oh boy, the ultimate wisdom saving throw here.
Yes. If only I had a divination die.
Oh,
damn it. Alright, well, I guess we can just try to run, I guess.
It resists.
Yeah, you just run and I'll run.
You just run.
We'll all run.
It gets to go before you, though, Kalnar.
It does get to go before me, yes.
And I have a bonus action to where it can't attack me.
We are back up to Kethra first. What's Kethra want to do?
Wherever Kethra went.
Hey. Where did everybody go?
No one followed me.
You guys are supposed to follow.
5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Talus, what's happening?
What? Where are you?
I don't see you. Just a voice.
Oh, you don't see me? Oh, I only see the door.
Oh, is the door open for him?
Should be. But it's still pretty fucking dark in there.
There you are.
Oh.
There's no, I don't think there's any light spilling in there, so I don't think you can see it at all.
Yeah. Oh. Well, whatever. I still ask you. What's happening?
There's a giant monster in here that's, killing us.
Killing us all.
Yeah, just like any other day of the week.
Are we trying to kill it?
I think
we're trying to run.
We're trying to run. Do you have any magic ball bearings?
Magic ball bearings.
I do not have any magic ball bearings. I can shoot it.
Well, you better roll better than a 17.
I'm going to shoot my crossbow then.
Oh, good.
Crap.
Nope.
That's not going to do it.
Now, okay.
Then I dash the other way.
Then I dash. Run away!
Mary?
Hey, it's my bonus action. I will take step on the wind, and I will disengage. 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. I'm assuming this is where Kethra went. Can't get through the door. 40.
Hi, Mary.
I'm just feeling out like this at this point.
It's like pitch dark.
Kethra, light a damn torch.
Kethra can see you walking like that.
Umber Hulk will turn around and attack Kalinar.
Of course you will.
Sorry, Kalinar.
Oh boy.
It hurts.
Ha! Goddamn!
As you parry the blows left and right. If only I had advantage.
Oh boy, okay.
Run for it!
Kalinar
is going to first, as a bonus action, cast Shield of Faith on himself. So now I know there's at least one advantage attack coming, or reaction attack.
Mm-hmm.
Pick up the torch before you run.
Is it right next to me?
More or less.
Kinda.
Back to the map. Alright, I'll grab the torch.
Okay, not just disengage.
I don't have that. Is that an action?
You can just use it as a reaction.
But I need to dash, too.
Oh, those are one or the other, yeah.
Okay, yeah, so I'm going to dash. 5.
So you're picking the torch up? That torch.
Yeah.
Alright, so I'm going to delete that, and I'll just give you the light.
Okay.
You are the light.
So that's 5, 10, 15... 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45.
Oh!
Oh, holy fuck!
Oh, no!
I don't make it, guys!
The reaction shot was a crit! Oh my god!
Hey, what's your dice? Tell
what's
us!
What's your armor at?
19.
Okay. Can tell us what from a slumber once again?
I can really use a dice. It's less than 19.
I'll allow it.
Talos says, that's not how this happened.
You saw a Final Destination style death scene of like him being ripped in half as he ran past the Umber Hulk. And then you suddenly snap to, and he's still, like, currently about to run. And you're like, wait. There's a giant, gloved, bladed claw hand coming for your midsection. You might...
I just yelled, duck.
Yeah. Alright.
So what is the dice you have?
18.
18! Awesome!
You're one away from
being only because you actually cast Shield of Faith. Does that work?
Yes. Holy shit! Alvin just like, literally ripped in half.
I am like, Gonzo.
Alright, I think I'm gonna get here. Okay, my turn's over.
Talos, he literally wipes away the sweat. I like my new toys.
Talus will cast light on himself. Or on one of his ball bearings. Whatever.
Good thing you said bearings.
My balls light up with an eerie glow.
I guess they're bullets. Yeah. They're so bright. Talus just sort of squints at the creature and goes, huh, I think I've seen something like him before. And takes off.
I'm gonna slam the door shut as he comes through.
As he comes through?
Yeah.
No door for you. You can do that on your
Talus turn. Talus is trapped in the door.
Fine.
Kethra?
Oh good, you guys made it.
God damn it, Kethra! God damn it! I was almost gored today.
His life flashed before his eyes.
I made an escape path for you. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. I want to open this door.
Close the door.
Yeah, close
it first and see if you can get through, then open the door.
Oh, maybe he has a chance.
But... what if there's other side?
Oh, man.
Same thing requires a strength check. It's not locked, but it's you can tell this door is actually, like... It seems like it has not been, like, in regular use.
Oh. Wow. Kevin is surging with adrenaline. She is all adrenaline and no conscious thought at this point. She just...
Run for it!
30. I'm gonna dash. And as she's dashing, follow me!
Kethra, this barrel vaulted chamber is obviously an ancient crypt.
Niches
along the walls hold dozens of old skeletons, some with scraps of burial cloth still clinging to their bones.
Well, I have a feeling something is about to come alive in that room.
A bone dragon bites your head off.
Now.
It's okay, guys. There are more doors to open.
As long as there's more doors, we have a way forward. Miri.
I shall now slam the door shut.
And presumably step away from the door, just in case one of those giant fucking sword arms can stick through a 5-foot door.
Well, you know what?
That takes all of
I did say away. That Kethra smashed that door open because of the critical hit, so I'm not sure that door still exists.
Of we'll course
just,
step it
away. Just step away from it. The
we'll put it like commercial.
Fit.
25, 30, 35, and 40.
The moment of truth, Kalinar.
Will it fit or will it not fit?
Will it fit?
Is this a YouTube series?
Will it fit?
5, 10, 15, 20, 20, oops, 25. 30.
You just counted 20 twice.
Alright, he was here. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. And it will scream angrily as it tries to move its arms and maneuver in there. It immediately goes to the ground and tries to dig. And you guys recall that Umber Hulks enjoy burrowing through the earth and popping up and killing people.
Holy.
However, you notice the Umber Hulk gets super angry because its bladed artificial claws do not seem to be churning up the earth. And it just angrily claws, and that will take its action as it tries to dig under, and it is unsuccessful.
Wait, is this dirt or stone?
The only
okay,
way
it's
that you can trap
an Umber Hulk. Can we now just throw shit at it until it's dead? Because I'd like to do that.
Let's do that.
Let's do that.
It's not a bad plan. I still have darts.
It is Kalinar's turn.
Yes. Let's just... Okay, Kalinar just... starts throwing spears at the Umber Hulk. I do not get to reroll that. That's just 5 damage.
22 will hit. However, it is resistant against non-magical attacks.
Really?
Which means it takes half damage, so it will take 2 damage.
This plan now is a little
the thing
more flawed.
Barely seems to graze it.
He'll step for his second attack. He'll step right here and use a lance to lance out at the thing. Mm.
The lance is that does hit. The lance is also non-magical, however, so it'll take half damage.
So 5 damage. This may take a while, but we can do it. I'm sure of it.
That's a great pep talk. Tell us.
Oh, do I want a chance? Do I want to chance it? Oh.
You want a chance?
I roll Scorching Ray. I roll so poorly on attack. I'll cast Magic Missile for the guaranteed at level 2.
Yeah, that's if you gotta actually roll an attack roll, I would say, yeah, don't do it, because that's solid. 17?
Yep.
That is magical. That is full damage. Darts slam into the creature. Kethra.
Kethra is not sure why no one is following her yet.
Damn it, Kethra.
Is her adrenaline finally starting to come down?
Huh?
Like her fight or flight reflex.
10, 15, 20. What are you guys doing?
We have it trapped.
Yeah.
Alright, sounds good to me. She just pulls out her crossbow and shoots at the thing.
I didn't accept 17.
17 is not going to do it.
No.
Mary.
Okay. Back a little closer.
If only there was a button next to... Or a button that was... led to a door right above the Umber Hulk. You could press and have it crash it down.
Mm-hmm. I don't have anything magical, so... I still have that potion of animal friendliness. Can I throw that at it yet?
No! This creature must die!
Your mace is magical, if you want to walk up and attack it.
Yeah, but then it can attack me back.
Yeah.
Probably.
So that's a brilliant plan. Well, I'm already almost dead.
Ranged magical equipment.
I don't have any ranged magical equipment.
Yeah.
I'll just pink it with darts every now and then. Well, maybe one of them will hit eventually.
To no effect, yeah.
Oh, wait, I get to attack again though, right?
Yeah.
Nope. I'm getting close to that damn thing.
Creature seems to pace in a giant rage now, using it some of its movement, and it actually physically crashes against the wall right here.
Alright,
we'll roll a strength check, and it will need to roll a 20 or higher to crash through the wall.
Oh good, there's a possibility of a 20.
Something tells me this guy's strength modifier is high
enough. He seems pretty fucking strong. Not strong enough to get in there. Would still take a good roll. So that was his action. Kalinar.
Kalinar will continue trying to stab the thing with his lance.
4 will hit him with the lance. Takes 4 damage.
And this time, when he pierces his skin with the with the lance. Where is it at? Oh, yeah. The same golden light extends out.
And... extra damage.
Oh, God damn, that's awful. Oh, it's 1d8. Why did I only roll 1d8?
Yeah, 2d8.
Okay, so it just takes 8 radiant damage.
Another 8 damage, alright. He does appear to be fairly wounded. He's taking a lot of damage.
Alright, he's going to lance out again. Not going to hit that time.
Nope. Tell us.
I don't want to go. Alright. Talos is running low on spells. For he will cast magic missile at level 1. One more time. For 9 damage.
Okay. All the darts slam into the creature. It appears to be bleeding profusely from multiple wounds now, and it is, seems like it has slowed down from its initial rampage, but still quite irritated and wants to eat you. Kethra.
What to do?
You can't dodge around this thing like you normally can.
I know.
Stymied by this method of attack.
I will cast sleep on it.
It easily shrugs off.
It's more than 16.
Yeah.
Wow. 2 1s.
Yeah, that was terrible. 5d8. You should be getting at least in the 20s.
So, cast Water Whip and hope for better damage this time. Water Whip. And that should be magical, right?
Yes.
Not better damage.
Seems better.
A little less than average.
Yeah. Next save. Fails. No. Would you like to try to pull him closer?
No. I will knock him prone.
Alright, he takes 14 damage as he slams to the ground. And is knocked prone. He will stand back up. He doesn't have to move anywhere. And attempt to crash through the wall again. Same roll, needs 20 or higher.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, shit.
He crashes through the wall. He does appear extremely wounded, however. But that does not sate his rage as he lays into Kalinar.
Me crashing through the wall didn't take his action.
Action.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry, you're right. That does take his action. You're right. I just love to scare Christopher, that's all.
I just
love to critically attack him and then say, never mind. I derive much pleasure from that.
Look at those fucking attacks!
That's 34 damage.
That's insane.
That's my entire life.
Wow. That's my entire life. Flashing. Alright, so that was his action to crash through the wall. Now he's just breathing in front of you heavily. Kalinar's
life flashed before his eyes once again.
I've almost killed him so many times.
Kalinar's fear only serves as adrenaline for the next strike. We better fucking kill him next turn. Or I'm literally going to be severed in twain. Will the 19 hit?
19 will hit.
12 damage on that one.
12 damage is really solid. You sink your sword into its midsection. It gives off a howl as it kind of stumbles a bit. And just blood is gushing out of it actively. It appears extremely wounded.
Oh, God. How much life is left in this thing?
And again, 15's not going to do it.
15 will not attack. Not hit him. Alice. I assume you don't want to move away from him now.
That means magic missile needs to be at 2 or 1.
Yeah.
Do you hear him? He's trying to conserve his magic missile while you stand there in front of this thing. What is your life worth, Galadar? Is it worth
a level 1 spell or
magic missile?
But there's two other people after me. Odds are
that we will all critically fail.
Yeah, that's true.
I will be cut in half.
How many times must I tease the cutting of the half? It's been foretold.
Alright, there's my last spell slot.
How much damage?
13.
The four darts pierce into the creature, and one of them goes right into its brain. Flies out the other side with brain matter. And the creature has crashed through the wall only to take a dart in the face. Exactly 13
damage. Was worth it.
Slays partially blinded Umber Hulk. One of the most exciting fights we've had in quite a while.
Kalinar falls to his knees and just kind of weeps silently.
Actively Alice crying.
Looks at him disgusted, like, pull yourself together.
Come on, man.
Muriel walk up and just slap him.
I'm fine.
I'm gonna hand him a lace tissue and be like, here, Kalinar.
Oh, my goodness. I think this will make a good stopping point.
Oh, God.
As we're coming down from this. Hopefully we'll remember the situation that you guys were basically entrapped down here. But you did manage to defeat the monster in the end. I do need to reward experience.
Umber Hulk with fucking brass sword arms. What is he worth?
BT Dubs, you can loot that.
Okay.
And somebody can have fucking Umber Hulk brass sword arms if they want to. I have stats for this. It's a thing. If you want to do it now, we can do it next week.
I don't know. What kind of weapon is it?
Let's look at it. These are called Claws of the Umber Hulk.
I think Tal should get these.
These heavy gauntlets of brown iron are forged in the shape of an Umber Hulk's claws, and they fit the wearer's hands and forms all the way up to the elbow. While wearing both claws, you do gain a burrowing speed of 20 feet, and you can tunnel through solid rock at a rate of 1 foot per round. I have no idea why the item lets you do that, whereas it specifically said the creature can't do that.
Right.
It makes no sense.
Maybe because it's too big for the actual arms?
Maybe. You can use a claw as a melee weapon while wearing it. You have proficiency with it automatically. It deals 1d8 slashing damage on a hit, plus whatever your modifier is. And it specifically says while wearing the claws, however, you cannot manipulate objects or cast spells with semantic components, because they cover up your fucking hands.
Okay.
So essentially, they let you burrow through the ground and even through solid rock.
Okay, so they're more utility items than actual weapons.
But you can use them as a weapon if you wanted to. They're not a magical hit, but they do just 1d8. It's like a long sword or something.
Okay.
You pissed me off.
What did you say earlier? Burrowing speed of 20 feet?
Yes.
Yes.
Normal ground, and then even through solid rock, you could go at a rate of 1 foot per round, which
what was that?
You pretty much couldn't do that during combat, then I would think, but at least not very effectively.
You only go 1 foot per round
in solid rock, but in ground, just like dirt or something, you have a burning speed of 20 feet.
per round.
Right, yeah, the speeds are per round. It's like how you have a walking speed of 30 feet or whatever.
Got it.
Yeah, it's sort of like Misty Step, bow, but worse.
And then does it have finesse or anything?
It says you have proficiency, so I don't know if finesse works for certain weapons.
Sneak attack. I'll have to look it up.
Yeah, I don't think so.
I can't imagine it would be better than your weapons, Gethra.
Mine's a 1d8 also.
Oh, yeah.
And proficiency brings it the same. I just need to know if I can do a sneak attack or not.
It does say your strength modifier applies to the attack and damage rolls as normal. But I know some of you don't use your strength modifier, so. Alright, XP. For the vultures and the hawks, it should be 550 total. It was two vultures at 200 apiece and six bloodhawks at 25 apiece. Should equal out to 550 total. The three monk guys at the gully were worth 450 apiece, so times three is 1350. The three Ankh eggs, giant insect guys, on the way over here were same thing, 450 apiece, and three of them, so that's 1350. You guys didn't fight anything in the monastery until the Umber Hulk. The Umber Hulk, by the way, is a challenge rating 5, which I believe makes it the strongest thing you guys have killed yet.
I believe it.
Yep.
Which means
he did have to cheat a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. And he is worth 1,800 experience by himself.
I have a total of 5,050 experience before division.
5,050?
Mm-hmm.
That's a good amount of experience.
Divided by 4 is 1,262 experience apiece.
Wow.
Well, that's what we already had.
Says the partially blinded Umber Hulk.
Makes our new experience total 9,663.
Wow.
All right. If we plow through 1,000 experience a night, then it won't take too long to get to the next level.
That was a good amount of combat encounters. We got through 4 combat encounters this session, which is pretty huge.
Yeah.
All right, we'll definitely call it a break here, and we'll resume next time with the fallout of you guys being stuck in the dungeon of this dungeon.
my personal adrenaline has to go down now.
So hyped up for that. Thank you to Chris, Heather, Raymond, and Reese. I am Eric. We'll be here every Sunday evening at 9 p.m. Central Time doing Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition online. See you guys next week. With more Umber Hulks.